Well, today I'm talking with David Baldacci, just released Long Shadows. That's part of the number one best-selling Amos Decker series. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
We took up a lot of time last time talking about all your accomplishments, but everybody knows that by now. So I got to tell you something. Can I talk to you a little bit about something else? Because I settled in to watch a movie last night and your name comes across the screen, right? And the movie is called Wish You Well.
Oh, yes.
And yeah. Oh my God. I mean, I think of you as like the thriller guy, but when you write something like that, it's more like the lighter side of David Baldacci, huh?
Yeah, it really is. That was quite an experience writing the script for that film and, you know, being on the set and dealing with all the actors. Ellen Burstyn was a delight. Josh Lucas was just extraordinary and a lot of young, really talented actors. So it was fun.
Do you remember when you first heard that phrase, wish you well?
Yeah. God, you know, everybody's heard of the wishing well, which is kind of a derivation of where that came from, but it really comes from we named our foundation, our literacy foundation, after that Wish You Well Foundation, because in seeking to give people stronger reading skills and literacy skills, we're actually wishing them well.
Yes. And
it will improve their lives and make their lives better.
Yeah. And you know, the film was beautiful. It was filmed in Virginia. What was it like for you growing up in Virginia as a young person?
Yeah, it was interesting. I mean, I grew up with a very ethnic last name and I was, you know, living in the old Confederate capital.
Yeah.
Where you go down Monument Avenue and you see, you know, these huge statues of Jackson and Davis and Stuart and Lee. And it was interesting. I mean, I grew up in the 60s and 70s there, and it was very, still very segregated. And it was an opportunity to observe a microcosm of life in a way that then you could expand out in many ways. And I have to say that the library really saved my life, because my parents took my brother and sister out of the library and I got to travel the world through books. I would have had a very different outlook on life if I hadn't grown up in a place like that.
Yeah, you said, I think I heard you say that if you weren't a reader, you wouldn't be a writer.
No, it's absolutely true, because it gets into your blood and you get to the point where, you know, my mom gave me a little journal when I was 7 years old and told me to start writing in it because I had all these tall tales I would continually tell. And I was the kid in our neighborhood who was designated to come up with all of our adventures. You know, it scripted out the battles we were going to fight and the journeys we'd be on. And I just love that stuff. And so, yeah, being surrounded by books as a kid, that gave me a passion that I have to this day.
Wow. You know, your mom was, I think, Joyce Rose. And then your grandmother was Cora Rose, right? And
right.
And did you learn like storytelling from them? Because if you were kind of doing that as a kid, that had to come from somewhere.
Yeah, but when my grandmother lived with us for the last 10 years of her life, she was an invalid. So before I went to school every day, I would go and visit her in her little bedroom, and we would talk about stories. She would tell me about her time as a school teacher in Appalachia in Southwest Virginia, and being the mother of 10 children. And living a very hard scrabble life. I mean, I've been up to the old homestead. Now the land has reclaimed it. It's no longer there. Mm. But it's not a place you can get to easily. But as my mom said, you know, when I actually interviewed my mom when I was writing the novel, Wish You Well, because it was set in that location. So I needed to know what life was like back then.
Sure.
And it was amazing. She was remembering things in such vivid detail, you know, 50 years later. And I said, Mom, you know, most people have a hard time remembering what they had for lunch.
Yeah.
How do you remember that so vividly? And her response has stuck with me over the years. She said, son, when you grow up that way, you never forget.
Mm.
So it was quite poignant.
Yeah. In the film, there was a scene with Lou. Is the other character's name Cooper?
Oz.
Okay. Well, this was when someone, it was an older guy, and he asked, how did it feel to sell your first story? And how did it feel for you to sell your first story?
It was, you know, not to sound cliche-ish about it, but it was a dream come true, but one I never thought was going to come true, because as the years went by, I mean, I was 34 when I sold my first novel.
Wow.
And I'd had, you know, a lot of misses along the way and a lot of rejections along the way with other stuff that I'd written. And I almost got to the point where I was going to continue to write, but I just didn't think I was ever going to be published, because I just thought, well, you know, I'm not going to get the break I need. You know, I'm going to be in the right place at the right time. So it was pretty an amazing moment. You know, I remember sitting in my office at my law firm, and nobody in my law firm knew I was even writing anything. So I couldn't help anybody. You know, it was kind of my secret.
And that's where you learned?
That's where I learned. Yeah. When my agent called and said the book had sold for, at that time, was the most money ever paid to a first novel in the history of the country. And I didn't believe him. I thought he was lying. And then the chairman of Time Warner Publishing called, and I was like, okay, this is either the biggest prank in the world or it's legitimate. So there you go.
Oh my God. How much fun. I mean, you're such a diverse writer. I mean, you have this, you've written some kids books, wish you well. I mean, it's like, I just love that movie. I can watch it definitely again. I was online, I was reading, and some of the reviews, like one lady read one of your books. She said, if you've ever read Baldacci, you know, his plot lines are very, very detailed, convoluted, and constantly shifting. So are his characters. You can read for 2 hours, be on the same character, but by the time the book is over, you feel an intimate connection with all of them, even the truly nasty ones. Yeah, I mean, what's the ultimate compliment? So tell me, who is Amos Decker? Who is Amos Decker? Describe him to me.
So he is a former professional football player. He's huge, 6'5", 300 pounds. He suffered a traumatic brain injury on the field when he was blindsided on a kickoff. And he almost died. And he came out of a coma with two attributes he didn't have before. One is hyperthymesia, which is perfect recall. And the other one is synesthesia, which is a pathway commingling of your sensory pathway. So he sees dead bodies in an electric shade of blue. And these are true conditions. People have
them.
And so he couldn't play football anymore. So he became a police officer in his native Ohio, then a detective, and now he's a consultant for the FBI.
And he goes on all these different adventures. I mean, and you know, like I read part of this here, and I'm thinking, like, people have said, oh, you have a good memory, but it's different. Like, is your memory the same? Do you have a good memory or not so much?
I have a good memory, certainly, and it depends on what the subject matter is. It could be very good memory. I don't have a photographic memory like Amos Decker has. Very few people do. I think in the whole world, there are only like 100 people who have hyperthymesia, and he's one of them. Well, he would tell you, depending on the day, he wish he wasn't one of the 100.
Right, exactly. It's good remembering the good stuff, not so much with the others. Are you working on another one? I mean, I know that this just came out, but I'm always thinking ahead. Like, what are you up to next?
Yeah, so the next book is called Simply Lies. It'll be out in April, and it's two women are the lead characters, antagonist and protagonist, at least early on in the novel. It's a different book, different subject matter, different plot. It was sort of suggested to me by a podcast my wife recommended that I listen to, and I was so intrigued by the occupation of one of the characters in the podcast that I decided to build a character with that same occupation. And I had a blast writing it. It's just a really fun, you know, takes you in places you haven't gone before. At least I hadn't.
How fun. You know, I read something in the back of the book, and when you just talked about creating a character, it says to the charity auction winners, and you name a couple of people, I hope you enjoyed your character. So did you actually write about them?
Yeah, so what happens is that people, I will donate a character name to an auction. It could be to the Cancer Society, it could be the American Heart Association, it could be the MS Society, lots of different charities. And so they auction the name off and the money goes to them. And then I will create a character in the book with that name.
Oh, wow.
In Long Shadows, one of the charity auction winners, her name is Casimira Rowe, and she's a pretty principal character in the novel. And she's of Slovakian descent. And I actually met her parents when I was at the Mark Twain House. I give out the Mark Twain Literary Prize every year.
Oh my gosh.
And I met her parents, and they were the ones actually who had won the auction and had paid the money to the Mark Twain House for. And they told me that, I believe that Casimira was adopted, and she's from Slovak. She's a teenager or young adult. And so I said, tell me about her. And they said, you know, one of her greatest fears is that once she passes away, that no one will remember her. Mm. And so I sent her a signed copy of the book, as I do with all the charity auction winners. And I said, dear Casimira, I'm glad to let you know that you are officially immortal.
I love that. It's the perfect gift, you know. How do you know you're done with a character? Like, how do you know, okay, it's time to go to something new? Does a character dictate it, or do you?
It's a little bit of both. I think if there's no more meat left on the bone, or no more juice to squeeze out of a lemon, I've learned everything that character has to tell me, then I think it's time to move on to another character that I can flesh out in the same sort of way. And sometimes it's an easy decision, sometimes not so easy. In Long Shadows, I sort of took Decker on a new bent. You know, he seems really re-energized, and I learned more about him in this book that I hadn't known before. So he's got a brand new partner in Freddie White, and she goes toe-to-toe with him, which is not easy to do. And so I think that he's going to have a long shelf life.
Do you get to name your books? Do you ever like submit a name and then they say, no, we're not, we're going to do something different?
Never.
I love that. How did you come up with Long Shadows?
So it comes from an old saying, old sins cast long shadows. In the novel, that it, once you read the novel, you'll understand exactly what I mean by that.
Yeah. I've interviewed you before, and I know your mom gave you a notebook that kind of got you started. She says to keep you quiet, but what can parents do? You wish you well, you know, and you want to combat illiteracy. What can parents do to kind of get their kids either involved in writing or reading?
Expose them to as many books as possible, but empower them to select what they want to read. In school, oftentimes, you know, there you have a syllabus, you're told what you can read, which takes the power away from the kids, and sometimes they're turned off because of that. They're like, you know, I pick up my phone, I can go on TikTok and look what I want to look at, go on social media and look at what I want to look. I'm empowered, it's my control. You need to allow them to do the same thing with books. And if you do that, 9 times out of 10, once they read one and really enjoy it, they're going to be hooked for life.
Yeah, I've talked to parents who said they like go on a little adventure to the library, either Saturday morning or whatever, just to let the kids pick out, as you said, something that they wanted to read. But you have to, I guess you even have to have the exposure and the access to it as well.
And the same, and a lot of times parents will come to me and say, you know, I just can't get my kids to read their eyes on the computer. And I always ask them one question, and it's this, do you read?
Yeah.
Oh, right. Well, you know, in the evening, I'm catching up on some email and doing some work on the computer. Yeah, right. Yeah. Your kids are emulating you. Trust me, if you fill your house with books and the kids see you reading books, they'll read books.
That's what got me hooked. You know, I interviewed somebody recently. She wrote a book called The Attack of the Black Rectangles, Amy King. What are your thoughts on banning books? Her child brought home a book. I don't think it's The Devil's Arithmetic. And in the book, there was all these black marks, like breasts was a word that they blocked out. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, and you also have a feeling about it contributing, you know, literacy is kind of threatening our democracy, right?
It is. My feeling is in 2022, the last thing I thought I would be talking about was book burning and book banning. In this country. Now, look, it's an old playbook. It's a time-worn playbook. It's been used for thousands of years. And it always has a cataclysmic outcome, never has a good outcome. So, and I tell people, we were taught this in law school, the slippery slope is indeed slippery. So right now it's banning books that have something to do with, you know, LGBTQ people, right. Or it's because it's, you know, they consider it too sexual or pornographic. Next, it'll be, you know what, if they're talking about a religion that I don't really agree with, so we're going to knock that one out too. Right. Well, you know what, it's got too many female role models, and I think we should be a male-dominated society, so let's knock that one out too. Yeah. Oh, they're talking, and then all of a sudden, then it's like you're in Handmaid's Tale land.
Yeah, you're not talking.
You're not talking, yeah. So, you know, libraries are open to everyone. Parents should certainly have control over what their kids, certainly their young kids, you know, are exposed to and should read. But there are lots of great books out there that will expose kids to wonderful things, and their parents should allow them to read them. And as they get older, they can make their own decisions. Certainly when they're an adult, they can read whatever they want to read. But I ask the same parents sometimes, okay, you're so controlling about the books and you want to take this off the library shelf, even though, you know, they don't have to read it. It's not required. No. It's on the shelf. But do you know what your kids are looking at online?
Right. Right. That's the thing.
I can guarantee you whatever they're looking at online will be 10 times worse in your eyes than what is ever contained in a book.
That's so true. So well said. You know, David, you, I think this year, did you release 3 books this year?
I did.
So what's your writing schedule look like? Like what, how do you do that?
Yeah, it's,
do you have a life outside of writing?
I do, but when I'm writing, I push it really hard, pedal to the metal, and I let the ideas crystallize in my head. So when I sit down to write, I'm very productive. You know, the pages come out very quickly. And the faster I write is usually the better that I write. And again, I've never looked on this as a job. You know, I write a book in 6 months and I get paid a lot of money for it, and I could take 6 months off. That's not how I operate. I'm like, what's the next story? I'm right now, I'm sort of in between stories. I'm thinking about what to write next, and I'm frustrated because I don't have anything to write right now. And I'm not a, you know, not a happy person.
Yeah.
Stories have always been what drives me. And I think that's one reason, you know, I'm so prolific, because it's just a part of my identity. It's what I wake up every day wanting to do.
It's like you're percolating right now, right?
I am percolating.
and that bubble over is going to be coming soon. You just know it. Would you say you're structured? Are you a structured writer? When you're writing for a book, do you have to be?
You have to be disciplined, certainly. And you have to hit your marks and understand that the research you have to do and how you have to incorporate it into the book in a way that doesn't interfere with the flow of the story. You have to understand that you need to develop your characters fully so that readers will care about them. And you have to build out your narrative in a way that makes sense and is logical. And again, I'm telling a story like every other book, but then I have this puzzle overlay that I put on top of it, because I'm writing mysteries and thrillers, so I have to have misdirection and red herrings and clues and twists and turns. So it can be a complicated process. So you really have to be on your game.
Yeah, it would seem like it would be. That's why I asked. You know, there's a Vega Jane. Okay, you did the Vega Jane series. How do you learn to write from a female voice? I'm going to let you take that. How do you learn to write from a female voice?
So I grew up surrounded by really strong, independent female role models. Both my maternal and paternal grandmother lived with us from time to time. My mother was a force of nature. I had 15 aunts,
So
a lot of aunts. My sister, very strong, independent. She grew up to be a journalist. I married a very independent woman, and we raised a very independent daughter, our oldest child. And so I feel very comfortable because as a kid, I was quite the observer, and I just, you know, let it all soak into me. I saw how women reacted with other women. I saw how women reacted with men back there. And, you know, in the 60s and 70s, it was a different thing. Women had to come at it, at least in my opinion, from a different angle, with so many things closed off for them. But they still wanted to have accomplished goals, and they had things that needed to get done. They just did it from a different way, you know? And it was almost like, yeah, we will get this done. We'll let him think thought of it. But at the end of the day, we're going to get to where I need to go.
That's exactly right. You've written standalone books. You've written series. Is one more difficult or easier to write?
I think the series are probably a little more difficult because it's not one and done. So I have to hold stuff back for future books. I can't let everything out in the first book, and I have to sort of plan accordingly. If I describe a character a certain way and they got certain things going on in their life and they have personal information, I need to make sure that's going to be right, because it's going to carry through in all the other books. It's not right. Like I change physical dimensions about the person or their background. So you really have to think that thing through pretty clearly. And sometimes you can fudge it a little bit to give yourself wiggle room, and I've certainly done that. But you really have to hone in on that and know that you're in it for the long haul.
Your books are in different languages. They're in audiobooks. Do you voice your own audiobooks?
No, but I choose the readers.
That's what I was going to ask.
They audition for me, and like The 620 Man is one of the best audiobooks they have ever done of any of my work, and I listened to that thing twice because it was so compelling. So there are three readers for that, one man and two women, and they just did a terrific job, and I picked all three.
Yeah. And then what do you like to do in your downtime? Virginia, shoot, I'd just be walking around in the beautiful fall colors.
Yeah, I know. I'm a big walker. I love to walk. I love to walk our dog. In the summer, you know, we have a home on a lake, and we do all the water sports, sailing and boating and skiing and paddleboarding and all that. I've thought of a lot of good plot lines when I've been out paddleboarding at 6 o'clock in the morning.
And then lastly, I know you have to go. Tell me about feeding body and mind. You're doing this thing around the country, and oh my gosh, I just love it so much. When we were talking about access to books.
Yeah, so we came up with that as sort of an adjunct to our Wish You Well Foundation. So when I go down on book tour, I send out these big boxes. My fans fill them up with new and gently used books. We pay to have those boxes shipped to local area food banks. The Feeding America runs all the nation's food banks. They have this huge pipeline, and they can push through food through it, obviously. My thought was, well, let's try to push books through it as well, because people seeking food assistance often have lower literacy skills.
Right.
Poverty and illiteracy go hand in hand. So we have, you know, distributed millions of books over the years to people and gotten in the hands of people who maybe never had a book before. And I know that books can change people's lives and put them in new directions and make them better people, because it happened to me.
Yeah, books can free people. That's what I think books can do. They can take you wherever you want to go. David Baldacci's new book, Long Shadows, amazing. It's the Amos Decker series. It's available in your local bookstore. When I go to any store, there's your name. It's like the weirdest thing. And so, must be even weirder for you. And so you can get it at your local bookstore, online, everywhere. Do you even have time to reach out? Or are you on social media?
Yeah, I've got it's davidbaldacci.com is my website. And then it's tagged on my Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and all that stuff.
Okay. I know it's a grueling day doing 5 or 10 hours of interviews. So thank you. Thank you so much for your time.
You bet. I enjoyed it very much. Thank you.
Me too.